welcome, everyone. I'm speaking today with Christian Rohner from the Communication Museum. Welcome, Christian, and congratulations on being selected as a laureate this year for the Best in Heritage. And maybe just to get going, if you can give us a little bit of a background on your project and you know, the intentions around it and how it began to manifest.
Thank you. First of all, I would like to tell you something about the museum. The Museum of Communication is a very old museum. It's over 100 years old. Now it's a private and non-profit foundation of the Swiss Post and the telecom company Swisscom. The museum is the only museum in Switzerland dedicated exclusively to communication and its history. And through its exhibitions and activities, it explores the social and cultural effects of communication and its technologies. 3 years ago, the museum opened the new core exhibition. For this exhibition, we received the Council of European Museum Prize. The following film actually shows a fly through the thematic exhibition and its six zones.
What do you find are sort of the greatest opportunities and then also the greatest challenges within your museum and maybe even in particular right now where communication technology is at such a phase of evolution and rapid evolution and adoption, and how does that play into, you know, your collections or your expression of content?
Opportunities of our rapidly changing technologies for our museum are enormous. First of all, we stay relevant. People come to us with real questions of their daily life. What is fake news? how to inform yourself in a digital world with so many sources. How to become a YouTuber, an influencer or hacker. But also teachers visit us to educate their pupils with themes like the value of truth, the impact of lying, privacy, secrets, understanding and misunderstandings, just to name a few. The challenge is to find objects which illustrate those topics. For example, we asked the famous influencer of Switzerland to have their high heels in our exhibitions to illustrate the influencer theme. But it's not always easy like that to find such an object or placeholder to attract the visitor for such immaterial topics.
Yeah. So, I mean, there's a lot of complexity around producing this project. And I think that what's fascinating to me is the position of museums now trying to pivot a little bit in terms of how they evolve museum practices based on the due diligent history of practices. And even something as simple as framing your exhibition as a core exhibition and not a permanent exhibition, I think is something that's really important. It's something that I've done in my past as well on different projects, is this idea that the museum core exhibition is always in a state of evolution. It's always attempting to reflect the perspectives and thoughts as they evolve amongst the public. And so would you say that now the sum of the outcomes of these complexities is really a benefit to the museum? Are you seeing an increase in visitation or engagement amongst visitors due to the fact that you had to overcome these complexities in your project development?
The core exhibition is always in a state of evolution. I think that is very important. As we saw, communication is evolving rapidly, not only technology-wise, but also the society. A core exhibition, in my opinion, where COVID-19 is not a theme in the future, it will be feel old. The challenge is, how can an exhibition evolve? When we designed the exhibition, we defined spots where you can dynamically curate. Dynamic curation was our answer to be actually update friendly. That means we have screens with a CMS where you easily can update or change content. There is no printed text. We have vitrines where you easily can put new objects. And most important, we have responsible people who check if things have to be changed or updated. The exhibition is designed in six thematic zones, and every zone has its educational goal. So a new topic has to fit in a zone. For example, I would put COVID-19 in the zone Labor, where direct communication plays a big role. We tried to break down the universe of communication in basic questions, which are grouped in those zones. Until now, we always found a spot to put a new theme. Those questions and zones help us to keep the exhibition coherent over several years. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, and I really think that, you know, traditionally, we would be having this conversation on a stage in Dubrovnik, and now we're having this conversation over Zoom. And so, you know, we see how, you know, in terms of ICT, information communication technologies, is probably the field that is most disrupted, and like in a continued cycle of evolution and adoption and then further expectations. And so I find it fascinating to build a museum and an exhibition around this concept when it is so dynamic. And I'm wondering, like, how are you collecting, you know, visitor and community, say, insights and interpretations so that you are constantly meeting the expectations of the public that's going to experience the exhibition?
Mm-hmm. We did a difficult but bold decision. We removed the staff selling tickets, making tours and guards. We introduced a new profession, the communicators. They do all together. There are 20 people. They are staff member of the museum. They are permanently employed. They received a special training of several weeks to get to know all the themes, but also the skills to communicate on eye level, we call it, with our visitors. And it's those communicators who know if a theme works in the exhibition, if something is missing, or a visitor has a nice anecdote or even found a mistake. For example, we have a cell phone of a priest. His number is very well known by boat migrants. They can call this number when they are in an emergency on the sea. In the exhibition, a communicator met visitors who called to this cell phone. We now try to bring this story back to the exhibition by telling the communicator's special encounter.
Right. It must have been a great benefit to employee engagement also. If you're an employee and you're in that role, being trusted and equipped to do all of those different things must have a great impact on employee satisfaction and just engagement with the job.
Exactly. They not only get the spirit of the visitors, they also have a great spirit in their team. And it was wonderful to have 20 new colleagues who not only work in the exhibition, but also bring new themes in. They support the curators and even are sometimes some kind of curator themselves. They urge sometimes for change because they feel the society or the visitors urges for change. To keep the spirit high, it's not always easy, but our chief education and marketing does a great job. Until now, we did not have significant changes in the communicator team.
Excellent. Are you collecting sort of oral histories or an intangible heritage in this kind of way? Around the 1001 artifacts, are you actively collecting the different sort of personal perspectives or community perspectives on those artifacts?
I like this question because we were thinking several times about such a repository. We collect oral history actively by approaching employees of the post and telecom company. We collect news articles, communicators do daily activities, but we are not taking track of our changes over time really. At the moment, changes are only visible in our protocols and minutes or emails. They will go in the company's archive, so not very scientific friendly. But I can imagine when we think about a new permanent exhibition in some years, we will make a project that will make such an evolution visible.
I thank you very much for participating, and it was really great to hear more about your project. Congratulations again on being selected as a laureate for this year's Best in Heritage conference. And thank you.
Okay. Thank you.